with the due apologies for the delay, we will start today's program. We are assembled here to honor one of the greatest Sanskrit Tamil scholars that our land has produced, and also the most leading or authoritative person in the field of archaeology, a person having multifaceted activities, a very close friend of our research institute for more than 5 decades, a very close associate of Dr. V. Raghavan, Dr. Janaki, and now he is 87 years old, so he is the Pitamaha in this field. And all of us know that recently he has been conferred, awarded the title Padma Bhushan by the President of India. And this place is not strange to him, as well as we are not strange to him. He has delivered so many lectures here under different topics, and our former Secretary C.B. Madhavan was very fond of Dr. Nagaswamy. And in fact, he used to admire the way Dr. Nagaswamy used to present his lectures through PPT. And he also honored Dr. Nagaswamy through the Sanskrit Academy. And today we are assembled here for a lecture under Dr. S. Jayashree. This is called Dr. Jayashree Memorial Endowment. Dr. Jayashree was working here as a librarian in our research institute from 1983. And she took a lot of pains in restructuring the library here, because those days all the books were arranged in bulk. And after her marriage, she resigned the job, but she was working on many projects. She took different topics, mostly based on untouched subjects like volcanoes, things like that, as available in Sanskrit literature. One of the projects was on eclipse, and KSRA has published the book Eclipses in Hindu Life and Thought. This was done under Captain Srinivasa Murthy Endowment. And she passed away as she was afflicted with cancer, though she was in the Apollo Hospital for many days, months rather. She was always asking about the Sanskrit activities at the institute as well as outside. Whenever we used to participate in conferences outside, she used to ask who came, what were the papers and all that. And it's a very difficult moment for us, because we always remember her fondly. And all the books here definitely bear the stamp of her dedication. And we really miss Dr. Jayashree here. And she has also contributed a lot in the form of projects, as well as she presented a lot of papers. Her MPhil thesis was on Niti Dvishashtika of Sundara Pandya, which was subsequently published by Adyar Library Research Center. And she used to proudly say that you can't find even a single mistake in that book. And she did her PhD on the contribution of Atiratra Yajvan, which is yet to be published. And she also was proficient in German and many subjects. So in her memory, her husband, Sri Hariharan, and her family members instituted this endowment in the year 2001, and we have been conducting annual lectures. And this year, we have got the most eminent personality among us, Dr. Nagaswamy. And it is very difficult to talk about his credentials, and at least for me, it is just like showing the lamp before the sun. And he is a postgraduate in Sanskrit and PhD in Sanskrit archaeology. And one of the most important contributions of Dr. Nagaswamy is winning the case, famously known as Lord Nataraja case of London. And the judge in London, they have given excellent report about his way of defending and how he has interpreted, how he has argued, how he has established that the Natarajan idol was from our own place. All these things are in record. Of course, in Google we can see all these things. And for that he has been given so many titles. And even Mahapariva has given him complete blessings and also title. And he has been awarded so many titles from so many forums in India and abroad. And he has been a much sought after scholar. He has traveled almost all the countries in Europe, USA, Canada and other countries. And he has trained a lot of people. Some scholars, very young boys from Sanskrit College, were trained by him in Pondicherry, and they used to be amazed, even without light, how he used to touch the wall and read all the inscriptions. A very rare phenomenon that we can even think of. And we are really grateful to you, sir, for accepting to come over here today. And on behalf of the Kuppuswami Sastri Research Institute, we would like to first honor him and our respected President Sri T.S. Krishnamurthy. He does not require any introduction, former Chief Commissioner, former Chief Election Commissioner of India. He also readily agreed to come to this function. So now I request him to honor Dr. Nagaswamy on behalf of all of us. Thank you, sir. Well, Dr. Nagaswamy will be giving a lecture on Hindu life in the past. And he will be giving the PPT presentation also. Sir? Now I request Sri T.S. Krishnamurthy, sir, to offer his felicitations.
Very good evening to all of you. First of all, let me convey my apologies. I was coming from all the way from Gandhinagar. Where there was some statement we are preparing for Anna Hazare, who wanted a statement from us. So I was a little delayed by the traffic, so my sincere apologies. I shouldn't have come this late, but anyhow, I suppose there are things which are beyond us. Let me first of all compliment Kuppuswami Sastri Research Institute for organizing this endowment lecture. Thanks to Mr. Hariharan, a good old friend of mine. And I have been in Delhi for more than 24 years. I can tell you, there are many people who get a lot of Padma awards. There are very few who deserve them. I think Dr. Nagaswamy is one of them who richly deserves this honor by the government. And we are happy that Dr. Nagaswamy has got this honor, if not earlier, at least now. Dr. Nagaswamy is a very learned person. I don't have to introduce him to you. And I have read some of his writings, and we should be really proud that Tamil Nadu has got such a scholarly person. His writings in Tamil as well as English have been very lucid and very effective. And particularly on the Indian calligraphy and Indian architecture, his views have been very valuable. And I'm happy that he has been associated with the Kuppuswami Sastri Research Institute, which in my opinion also deserves more recognition than what it has got so far. But we are trying our level best to modernize this institution, to provide more facilities. And fortunately, there is a lot of international recognition to this institute. And with persons like Dr. Nagaswamy, I am sure the institution will grow further into prominence. Thank you very much. And my sincere apologies once again.
Thank you. Mr. Krishnamurti sir and the authorities of the Kuppuswami Sastri Research Institute and friends. It's a great honor and privilege to receive this felicitation from the hands of Sri Krishnamurti, who has been holding the post of election commissioner of this whole country. You know, the country owes its election, of course, now from Western influence, but the originally the greatest elections were held here in Tamil Nadu, in Uttaramerur, where we have the complete constitution of election is written down, including the qualification and disqualification of the candidates to stand, and who is not allowed to stand, even if he is elected after one or two terms throughout his life, so that next generation takes over immediately. And all those clauses that are mentioned are all based on Dharma Shastras. And so it shows that it comes from the Vedic tradition. And I am glad that such a person has come and gladly accepted to give me this honor. And I am very thankful to you all who have assembled here for such a, in such large numbers. My first initiation into the study of Indian culture, I got it from Mahaperiyaval, and that I got it in this hall. Mahaperiyaval called me, I don't know, one day suddenly he called me on evening, and I told him, Okarra. And then he told me two things, that we have two brilliant masters in Tamil Nadu. One is Sir C.P. Ramaswamy Iyer, and the other one is Rajaji. Both are brilliant people, and no one can go to that level. And but there was one problem, that the public could not reach their height, and so they don't understand the value of these two great personalities. So what you have to do is, you have to go to the level of the public and tell them what is what, so that it is useful. And that was the first advice to me, that I should work with the people. And I had the privilege of working when I took over the director of archaeology post in Tamil Nadu, to go to the villages and work on the advice of Periyaval. And that blessings has brought me this great honor, and I am emotionally attached to this institution. The other point that I want to say is, I am in the midst of great personalities like Bharat Ratna, Sir S. Radhakrishnan, and then my own teacher in Sanskrit at the university, Dr. Raghavan, V. Raghavan, and my own guru in the field of archaeology, T.N. Ramachandran, Thiruvankade Narayana Ajwa Ramachandran. They were all holders of national honors. Like, Bharat Ratna by Sir S. Radhakrishnan, and Dr. V. Raghavan is a Padma Bhushan awardee. And T.N. Ramachandran as Joint Director General of Archaeology, he received Padma Bhushan award. And Ramachandran cousin, relative, Sivarama Murthy, one of the greatest contributors to the study of Indian culture and art, particularly art, who was the Director General of National Museum, he was also a Padma Bhushan. So there's a galaxy of Padma Bhushan awardees, and I am only a descendant of that particular tradition. Also, the last thing I would like to mention is, Kuppuswami Sastri is said to have been interviewed once for some professor post, and the person who interviewed him, he said to have asked him, Are you a PhD holder? Shastri said, no. Then how to consider you? Is there anybody who is your student? Then he said, Dr. V. Raghavan, Dr. T. N. Ramachandran, Dr. C. Shivaram Murthy. When he started narrating it, the interviewer stood up and said, such a great scholar, we are interviewing you. And then it is said that they all fell at his feet. And so that time, the honor was for the teacher, and their students gave the honor to them. And Kupsam Shastri is the sterling example of such a great teacher, and to stand in the hall in his name and in the institute in his name, I am extremely glad. And I am only a small the Padma Bhushan awardee in this tradition. So thank you, sir. My today's lecture is Hindu life in ancient times. Now, before I go and make it as brief as possible, I will ask my student to read a very important copper plate inscription of a Chola ruler, which has been discovered a few years back, which gives some very interesting details about the culture and life of the people, particularly of Tamil Nadu, which maybe I'll be enlarging it later, but first I'll ask her to read a small portion from that copper plate inscription, which is based on Dharma Shastra. So Dharma is the base of Indian culture, Hindu culture, whether it is in India or in Southeast Asia or in northern Afghanistan and Balochistan and other places, wherever they respected Dharma. It also went into what you call Ladakh and Tibet and China and Japan and so on. That is Hinduism, you can call. It's not confined only to India. We have to forget. It was on a very grand scale throughout. All that we now practice was practiced by all the people of Cambodia, Thailand, and Laos, Vietnam, and so on. There are references in their inscriptions to Dharma Shastras, which they followed. And whatever Dharma Shastra has prescribed as the life of people, they reflect it in their own inscriptions. Like Panchamahayagnas is a part of our life, as Grihastha mentioned in Manu, Yajnavalkya and other great Dharma Shastrakaras, that they have done in Cambodia, they have done in Thailand, in Vietnam and so on. And as you know, that greater number of inscriptions in Sanskrit are found in Cambodia than even in India, up to 14th century. So what you see, the whole of Indian culture, Indian philosophy, Indian literature, Indian temple culture, music, dance, that was not confined to this area, but it went beyond. And so when we say and we talk of Hindu life, it's not confined to unto the life of ourselves in this part of the country, but such a large area. And what she is going to read is an 11th century inscription, copper plate inscription, and I'll talk about it later. Only that small portion she will read, that's in Tamil and Grantha, you shall see. She is studying under me. You will see, read from here. You read from here. Okay. The portion of the
full portion. Full portion.
Okay.
Okay.
So let me read the inscription. I'm not going to the details. Already sir has given you the gist. So it starts like this. சாசனத்திலே பெருமானடிகள் ஆண்டு 9வது நாள் 350 நாள் கங்கை கொண்ட சோழபுரத்து கோயிலின் உள்ளால் கங்கை கொண்ட சோழன் மாளிகை திருமஞ்சனசாலை பள்ளிப்பீடம் ராஜேந்திர சோழ மாமலிபான ராஜனில் எழுந்தருளியிருந்து இப்பிரம்மதேயத்துக்கு அகர பிரம்மதேயம் ஸ்ரீ ராஜேந்திர சதுர்வேதி மங்களம் என்று திருநாமமும் கொடுத்தருளி இப்பிரம்மதேயத்து சபையோரையும் மற்றும் அனைத்து நாட்டுள்ள வித்வான்களையும் வைத்து கொண்டு எழுந்தருளியிருந்து வியவஸ்தை பண்ணின அருளினபடி இப்பிரம்மதேயத்துக்கு உண்ணமை செய்தாருக்கும் நான் செய்தபடி பரிபாலித்தாருக்கும் சூரிய கிரகணத்து கங்காசாகர சங்கமத்திலும் பனாரசியிலும் சால கிராமத்திலும் குருக்ஷேத்திரத்திலும் உள்ளிட்ட புண்ணியஸ்தானங்களிலே 1000 குரால் பசு உபயமுகியாய் இருப்பனவும் சதுர்வேதி பட்ட சர்வ கிரது யாஜிகளாய் தரித்திரராய் பகுக்குடும்பிகளாய் பிரம்ம வித்துக்களாய் இருப்பாருக்கு வஸ்திர அலங்கார பூசகிதமாக தானம் பண்ணினாருக்குள்ள புண்ணியம் உண்டாவதாகவும் மகாதேவருக்கும் மகாவிஷ்ணுக்களுக்கும் உத்தமோத்தம விமானம் இத்தேசத்திலே எடுத்து இக்காலத்திலே பிரதிஷ்டை பண்ணி தர்மம் உத்தமோத்தம பூஜை பண்ணினாருக்குள்ள புண்ணியம் உண்டாவதாகவும் தர்ம யுத்தத்திலே அபிஷிக்த க்ஷத்ரியனாய் அஞ்சாதே நின்று ஆயுதம் வழங்கி எதிரே புக்கு சரீரம் உட்டாருக்குள்ள புண்ணியம் உண்டாவதாகவும் ஆஸ்வமேதமும் இராஜசூயமும் உள்ளிட்ட கிரத்துக்கள் எல்லாம் உத்தம தட்சிணை கொடுத்து பண்ணினாருக்குள்ள புண்ணியம் உண்டாவதாகவும் இத்தர்மத்துக்கு அழிவு செய்தாருக்கும் இவ்வழிவுக்கு உடலானாருக்கும் இக்காலத்திலே இத்தேசத்துக்கும் இப்பசுக்களை ஷரீரம் விட்டாருக்குள்ள புண்ணியம் உண்டாவதாகவும் இப்பசுக்களையும் பிராமணரையும் இந்த க்ஷத்ரியரையும் இந்த புத்திபூர்வம் நிரபராதிகளாய் இருந்தாரை வதித்தாருக்குள்ள புண்ணியம் பாபம் உண்டாவதாகவும் விமானங்களை இக்காலத்திலே அழுத்தாருக்குள்ள பாவம் உண்டாவதாகவும் மகாபாதகம் அனைத்தும் புத்திபூர்வமே பல காலம் பண்ணினாருக்குள்ள பாவம் உண்டாவதாகவும் கிரதக்னர்களாருக்கும் சுவாமி துரோகம் பண்ணினாருக்குள்ள பாவம் உண்டாவதாகவும் ராஜவம்சத்து பிரித்தியராய் இருந்து பிழைத்தாருக்குள்ள பாவமும் துரோகமும் உண்டாவதாகவும் என்று இப்படி சமயமும் பண்ணிவித்தருளி அருள செய்தபடியாவது மேல் வருகிற ராஜாக்களை நோக்கி சொல்லுகிறேன் பூமி தானத்தில் உள்ள பலமும் பூமி ஹரணத்தில் உள்ள பாபமும் தர்மமும் அனுபாலத்தினாலே உள்ள பலமும் சேர்ந்து இந்த சமயத்தையும் பார்த்து இந்த தர்மத்தை ரட்சியுங்கள் என்று அருளி செய்து இந்த சபையோர் வசமே சாசனம் கொடுத்தருளினார். இது அவ்வவ காலத்து ராஜபுருஷர்கள் ரக்ஷை.
இது வந்து கிரீக் அண்ட் லாட்டின் மாதிரி இருக்கும், புரியாத மாதிரி. திஸ் இஸ் கிரியேஷன் ஆஃப் எ நியூ காலனி ஆஃப் பிராமின்ஸ் அக்ரஹாரா அண்ட் த கிங் த செகண்ட் ராஜேந்திர சோழ செகண்ட் சன் ஆஃப் ராஜேந்திரா ஹூ கான்கர்ட் அப் டு ஸ்ரீ விஜயா த கம்போடியா அண்ட் தாய்லாண்ட் அண்ட் other places, and he gives all these details in the copper plate. It is written on copper plates with his royal seal, and that gives an insight into what was the lifestyle of the people in the Tamil country, what are the kingship, what are the guiding factor for ruling the country. All this we get from this very well drafted copper plate. So idhi venuma indha light venuma, do you want this? You can paakka mudiyadhu illa, yeah, that will be. So I'll rush through the introductory part. Okay, let untuma. பரவாயில்ல. See, We start the history of our culture, understanding the history of the culture, poetry, music, everything from Vedas. So the earliest literature of India is the Vedas, consisting of mostly of hymns in praise of nature gods like fire, rain and Vayu, Agni, Vayu and so on. Here we find intensity of poetry and imagination. Vedic hymns are known for their poetic expressions. In the later Vedic poems, mostly in prose, we find two tendencies, namely ritualistic worship, which is karma, and the other one is the speculative thinking, the philosophical thinking. Next one. Next. The ritual tendency is more dominant than the philosophical one. It's clear, though the rituals were dominant mainly on the expectation of result. We want to get something done in return. The philosophical learning led to idealization. Now, that is the life of an individual is thoughtfully defined. This may be called laukika, the worldly life, and the other one is the shrauta ritual, shrauta culture. Next one, please. A man's lifespan was divided into 100 years. On an average, and was divided into four stages: brahmachari, grahastha, vanaprastha and sannyasa, called the four ashramas. The second point of importance are the purusharthas: dharma, artha, kama and moksha. That is the life. Next one. Man's life is oriented towards achieving these aims, ashrama and purushartha. Purushartha, though we have dharma, artha, kama and moksha, moksha is not generally described. Only the first three, dharma, artha and kama, are emphasized in all literature, and that is called trivarga. And the kings were expected to establish Trivarga Sthiti Chatra Dhyam. Pallava Kapraplate says they were engaged in establishing this Trivarga, Dharma, Artha and Kama. This led to the writing of Tirukural, which is called Aram, Purul and Kamam. The same division Valluvar follows. Now, the Dharma path, they included study, that is studentship, married life, grahastha, after fruition, begin to relinquish, learn to relinquish attachment, that is tapada, and devote oneself, and finally, to realizing the power of one's own self, that is sannyasa, that's also called sarva sannyasa. So that is atma, atma understanding, and now we call anmika. His only understanding of Atma at the final stage. Other things are all stages in the progress. Brahmacharya, Grahastha, Vanaprastha and Sannyasa, these lead man to progress in individual life. So these are dealt with in the Dharma Shastras. We have a large number of Dharma Shastras. One of the earliest one is Gautama. Gautama has got a Shrauta Sutra, Dharma Sutra. And then we have Manu, then Apattamba, what you call Bodhayana, Aswalayana, Drakhyayana, and so many sutrakaras are there. So we all belong to one or other sutra, Dharma Sutra, and in our daily life, birthrights, marriage rights and progress, we follow it. So we, if you ask someone, they will say, I belong to Apastamba Sutra or Bodhayana Sutra. But of course, in modern times, they don't understand what is Sutra. Many people are not able to say that. But still, we follow in our marriage rituals. And all rituals, domestic life, we follow the Dharma Sastra of particular sage. Agastya was also a Dharma Sutrakara. And all these are mentioned in the copper plate charters of the Cholas, who gifted many Agraharas, particularly in the Chola country. They list, we have some information, interesting information. This Rajendra Chola, first Rajendra Chola, who built the Gangaikonda Chola, he established a colony of Vedic scholars at a place called Puttur, near Saliyamangalam, near Tanjore. And he brought 1,000 Brahmanas, 1,008 Brahmanas, and established a Vedic college called Tribhuvana Mahadevi College. And there he gives the list of the number of students, the number of subjects like Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sama Veda, Atharvana Veda, and Griksha Sutras or Dharma Sutras. And also Valmiki, Ramayana and Mahabharata as part of the Vedic culture. And this he says that he established it in the name of his mother. And in this he followed what is said as Matri Devo Bhava, worship thy mother as God. And that he established. And his son, the second, third son, this is the second son whom I mentioned about, Rajendra too, the third son brought 50,000 Brahmanas from Karnataka, Andhra, and Telugu region, and brought them to Tamil Nadu. What is amazing is their complete address is available. From where they came, what was their Vedic affiliation, what was the Dharma Sutra they followed, and where originally they were settled and came. All these details are given amazingly in their copper plate inscriptions. And these inscriptions are drafted according to set style given by Yajnavalkya. When you make Bhuvudhana, you have to put it in writing, which is called Lekhya Pramana. And on the basis of this, the king gifted this Dana. Dana is one of the most important aspects of Hindu life, be it Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaisya, or even Sudras. And so how to give Dana is also mentioned in the Yajnavalkya Smriti, and that is exactly reflected in the copper plates. And that there is a technical word called Nibandha. This is given for this purpose, something like trust deed, and that they follow, and that's where we get all these details. Now, the first one, Dharma, deals with the individual life, birth, studentship, marriage, and tapestry, and then sannyas. All these are related to the individual's progress. The second one deals with the man in society. He has to earn. So he has to acquire wealth through legal means, approved means, and that money and property must be protected. And for this, the power was given to one selected life, and that is the king. And he has to give protection to the people so that they can earn, they can enjoy the benefit of the earning. And so that comes under artha part. Dharma is individual life. Artha is the man in the society, how he has to live. And in the process, he has to have this assembly administration, civil administration, and judicial administration, and also counsel, the right counsel, ministers, to advise him how to do it. And all these are all dealt within the art, the dharma and artha part. So artha shastra plays an important role in Hindu life. And then, now friends, now these divisions.